Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now revealed in flesh and bone, you are ocean.
his Son, Jesus is the good shepherd of your people. Grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads. That with you, the Holy Spirit, live and reigns one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The sound of praise to
you. Yeah.
Worship. That sounds great, yes. Woo! Praise the Lord indeed. In this reading, we learn that disciples are called to bear undeserved suffering with patience, even as Christ has set an example for us, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. A reading from the letter Peter, chapter 2. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. when he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that, free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're going to be singing the last song, or the second to last song in your world of music, gratitude.
Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
It was amazing. It was exciting. And once you found the breaking distance to the walkie-talkie, once the point to which the voice no longer came in clear, you would kind of start to walk back towards each other, closing in on one another, still saying, "Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?" Well, we just have bigger toys for bigger boys. Things really haven't changed that much, and perhaps you remember one of those early Verizon commercials, right? That's the whole premise of Verizon was, "Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?" We all look at the bars on our phone and think, "Can you hear me?" When you're talking about cell phones, and when you're talking on the cell phone and your call starts to drop, what's the first thing you do? "Can you hear me?" Or maybe you look to see if it's still counting, right? Like the timer's still on, which indicates like it hasn't been dropped off, you didn't get disconnected, you're just in a spot where they can't hear you. The signal's not strong. And so if that's the case, if the call wasn't dropped, and you are in one of those moments where you just can't hear the other person on the other end of the line, you start to move around, don't you? You start to kind of change your position. You make a movement, you change where you are and what's going on, and if you happen to be driving down the road, you simply wait a second or two until you move past the section that you think, "Well, I guess there's no cell signal here," or "it changed hours," and then you start again. "Can you hear me now? Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?" And eventually, you get reconnected. You get reconnected. And whether it's a walkie-talkie or one of these, it's frustrating, isn't it, when the signal breaks up. When you're talking on the phone, it starts going, "Bup, bup, bup, bup," and then it gets real clear and goes, "What do you think?" "I didn't hear anything you said. Can you do that again?" And or when the call actually drops off and you realize you've been talking to yourself for 5 minutes. Or the worst is when the call drops and you go to call the person back and it's busy. Like if they don't pick it up, it just goes straight to the voicemail. You know, they're still talking. They don't even know that I'm not on the line anymore. And you do that 2 or 3 times, like, "Okay, take a breath so you can hear my call." It's frustrating when the signal's not clear, when it's all jumbled up, or when it just plain drops the message. Because these devices, a walkie-talkie, a cell phone, they are intended for us to be able to share information with one another, relationship with each other. And it's frustrating when what we are intending to share is not able to be discerned, or not even able to be heard at all. When this happens, we move. We change our position. We move. We hope that the signal, which we really don't understand, right? You didn't understand those walkie-talkies when you were a kid, how they worked. They were amazing that they worked. You don't understand how your cell phone works. I know you know it goes off some kind of satellite in the sky and comes back to you. But if you were to tell me the actual principles of how it works, very few of us in here could probably do that. I'm sure there's a couple. But most of us don't know how it works. We just know that if we move, it works. If we get to a different location, it becomes clear. If we change our pattern, something takes place, and now we can hear and communicate once again, and that relationship begins to take place. Those devices become clear. They help us to reconnect and engage in the relationship that these devices enable us to enjoy. What if there were devices that would allow you to hear the voice of God? Would you use them? And if you did use them, and the voice of God started growing faint, if it became broken up, if it dropped out altogether, would you be willing to move? Would you be willing to make some adjustments so that God's voice would once again be clear? That you could engage in the relationship that those devices enable you to enjoy. There were devices that would allow you to hear the voice of God. Would you use them? In our gospel text this morning, Jesus says very clearly, "His sheep hear his voice." His sheep hear his voice. In all the years that I've been in ministry, the most common question that I'm asked is, "How do you know what God wants you to do?" This question may be expressed in various forms, like, "How do I hear the voice of God?" Or, "What does God's voice sound like?" Or, "How do I know if what I heard was actually God's voice? If it was actually God or not?" Many times, people will default to thinking that somehow hearing from God is not something they could ever receive because they don't understand how God speaks. And unfortunately, instead of moving, instead of making an adjustment in life, they just keep on living with God, but without engaging in a vital, life-giving, life-changing relationship with Him. Jesus' words, "My sheep hear my voice and follow me," they should make us stop. They should make us think. Because He is crystal clear. He is clear that His sheep will hear His voice and actually follow Him. And in following Him, there is the fullness of life that God intends for His sheep. Good pastures for them to live in, to feed in, to be nurtured in. He also is very clear in this same scripture text that we heard read this morning. If we are not following the voice of the Good Shepherd, then whose voice are we following? If we're not following the voice of the Good Shepherd, then whose voice are we following? Jesus is clear in this, and He says, if Jesus would indicate that if it's not Him, then we are following thieves and bandits who only come to steal, kill, and destroy. So when Jesus says His sheep will hear His voice and follow Him, we ought to stop and think. Am I listening to His voice? Am I following where He leads? If we can't say yes, then there's something more for us to learn. Somewhere for us to go deeper. There is a device that we can use to hear God speak. And I hope we want to pick it up and try it out. Jesus says His sheep will hear Him. They will follow Him. So how does this happen? How do we distinguish His voice from all the other voices calling out for our attention? How does Psalm 23, the psalm that we read this morning, that we know so well, how does that psalm become the song or psalm of our heart that describes our relationship to God? How we understand God to be our good shepherd. How does that psalm find that place? Peter writes in his epistle that we heard that it says Jesus Himself, He Himself, Jesus, bore our sins in His body on the cross, so that free from sin we might live for righteousness. By His wounds you have been healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your soul. The very first thing we have to do to hear God speak is we have to turn to Jesus. Now, you hear God speak before you turn to Jesus, it might sound like a donkey talking. He might get your attention with something, right? But if you want to hear God speak in your life over the long term, beyond just His getting your attention that you might come to Jesus, the first thing you have to do is come to Jesus. You have to turn to Jesus. You have to acknowledge that indeed we are a wandering sheep. That we have gone astray from God's wisdom. That we have gone astray from God's will. We have lived according to our own understanding. We have lived according to the bandits and the thieves. That's sin. That is sin. Living in our own understanding is sin. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Living to our own understanding is sin in our life. And so maybe we find ourselves coming to that place where we say yet again, God, I am a sinner in need of your saving help. And maybe it's the first time you ever come to that realization, and it is a place of salvation for you, where you say, God, I realize I am a sinner, that I have turned against you, I have betrayed your trust, I have turned against my brother, and betrayed your trust. And you say, God, I am a sinner. I need your saving help. Or maybe it's not an issue of salvation, but it's an issue of, are you going astray? Are you wandering away from the Good Shepherd? In any area of your life that you need to turn back to Jesus? And maybe that prayer then is like it is in our morning prayer in one of the suffrages, I'm not sure which one, where it talks about we need His saving help again. I mean, don't we regularly say, God, I'm a sinner. I need your saving help again. I know it's not an issue of my salvation, my eternity, my assurance with you. But I've found that I've wandered away from your truth. I've found that I've wandered away from your wisdom, from your will. And I'm out there getting all kinds of trouble. Even if I don't realize how much trouble it is. But I'm listening to other voices and not yours. So would you save me and help me yet again? Step one in hearing God's voice is getting closer to him through the redeeming work of Jesus. The redeeming work of Jesus on the cross. Have you returned to the shepherd and guardian of your soul? Have you returned? Will you recognize that inability to hear God's voice may be that you are too far away from him? Like a walkie-talkie. That you're too far away from him. Or his voice may be broken up by all the interference that is around you. And you need to move in a different direction. You need to make an adjustment. Will you turn or return to Jesus? If so, know for certain that your good shepherd, the good shepherd is indeed calling out for you, and he desires that you would hear his voice and that you would follow him. Let me also say that in returning to Jesus can be tender to our hearts. And it might involve an emotion that is hard for us to embrace. Let me encourage you. No one who knows the Good Shepherd, no one who knows the Good Shepherd is ever going to think you're weird for expressing the tender emotion that springs forth when you're in the presence of God. No one who knows the Good Shepherd is only ever going to think it's strange or unusual or weird if an emotion bubbles up because you're in the presence of God. In fact, those who know the Good Shepherd actually rejoice when we see that taking place. Because we know that when that happens, God is tending to your heart. God is tending to your soul in a way that only he can. So don't fight it. Don't hide from it. Allow the Holy Spirit to wash over you with his healing balm. And your ears will be open to hear the Good Shepherd, the guardian of your soul, as you turn to Jesus. Turning to Jesus is the first thing we must do if we're going to hear the voice of the Good Shepherd. Through the centuries, though, God has shared certain means of grace, ways in which this happens, ways in which we receive what God desires for us, ways in which God speaks and leads his children. These means of grace are conduits. They're conduits where we hear God speak. They are the walkie-talkies. They are the cell phones of the spiritual life. Turning them on, learning how to use them, provides the means for which we hear God speak, even if we don't really understand how it all works. But we know that it does. And we begin to engage in a relationship that these devices enable us to enjoy. And we see these devices in our reading in Acts this morning. In Acts 2:42, the scripture tells us, as Luke writes, those who have been baptized, now what does that symbolize? Those who have turned to the redeeming work of Jesus, right? Those who have been baptized, there's 120 on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 were added to their number that day, were baptized. It went from 120 to 3,120. And that group of people decided that they were going to try to figure this out. What did it mean to be this new community of Jesus Christ followers? And those who had been baptized, who had turned to the redeeming work of Jesus, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and the prayers. What does this mean? It means that since this time, and even before this time, those who heard God speak, those who followed the Good Shepherd, the Good Shepherd's voice used these devices called spiritual disciplines as a means to engage with the living God. Disciplines. Disciplines that led them to know God's heart. Disciplines that led them to learn God's wisdom. Disciplines that led them to discern God's will for their lives and for their community. Means by which God's grace was given, where people inside and people outside of the community could easily see and know that the Lord was their God, that they were his children. Can you imagine that? And Luke describes this by saying, awe came upon everyone. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. One of the most significant things that you can do to hear God's voice, to hear the voice of the Good Shepherd, to hear Jesus speak and follow him, is to become a student of the Bible. That means reading, marking, and inwardly digesting, as the colic says. But if we don't know what that really looks like, it means reading and meditating. It means studying. It means asking questions. It means digging to find answers. And it means applying what you read to your life. This is a profound statement. It's very confusing, though. There is nothing that you know in which you knew before you learned it. There is nothing that you know in which you knew before you learned it. What I mean by this is you did not graduate high school. You did not graduate first grade because you knew all the information before you started. You studied. You engaged with a learning process. And over time, your life changed. Because you began to apply, you began to learn, you began to apply what you learned to your life. And you learned how to tie your shoes. Go to the bathroom in the corner. And add 2 + 2. You didn't know all that when you started. But you studied, and you learned, and you applied it to your life, and your life has changed because of what you learned. Many people don't read the scriptures. Mostly because they think they already know what it says, even though they've never read it. Can you imagine that? I mean, could you imagine going to the doctor and saying, he's going to say, I'm going to cut you open and do surgery. I've never studied anything, but I slept in the Holiday Inn. Of course you would never submit to that. You know, it only makes sense to listen to what he says by reading his word and studying it and inwardly digesting it, meditating on it, thinking about it, asking tough questions, and then digging to find the answers, and then applying those lessons to your life. That's the only way it can happen when we study his word and hear his word and follow his word. Many people don't read it because they think they already know what it says, and they've never read it for themselves. How accurate do you think their understanding of the prayer of the scripture might be? Very much. And yet we live our life with that understanding. Can you imagine? That's foolishness. Other people don't read the scriptures to get this because they think it's too hard to understand. I've said that myself when I was a child. But I promise you, if you turn to Jesus, if you ask the Holy Spirit to teach you as you read the scriptures, you will begin to hear God speak to you. You're not going to maybe understand everything, but you're going to begin to hear God speak. It's going to come alive in you as you ask the Lord by the Holy Spirit to reveal his word to you, and you just start reading it as a discipline. The word of God will come alive and will pierce your soul. Now, as you read the scriptures, you might not like what you hear. You might like it. You may not like what you hear, but that's a whole different story. And that's what following Jesus and trusting in him is all about. Trusting that he actually knows the way to the good pasture better than the wandering sheep do. Like Jesus knows the direct course in your life to get you where you need to be. To hear his voice, to follow him, to live with him. Far better than the wandering sheep do who are telling you all kinds of other things. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. fellowship. Now, fellowship is not gossip around coffee hour, or gossip through Facebook or social media or whatever other form you want to use. That's not fellowship. Fellowship is relationships of accountability. Relationships of accountability is building relationships with other people who encourage you and who you will allow in and will actually invite them to speak tough words to you, to speak truth to you. When your life might not be aligning up with what God's Word has to say. Relationships that point you back to Jesus, back to following His voice when they see something that's not where He would desire you to be. It's a relationship of someone who you will actually ask for help. When you read His Word and you go, oh my goodness, the Bible says that's not supposed to be part of my life. I've lived my whole life thinking it's okay. I need some help with this one. Someone who you will invite into your life to share your life with over the struggles and the trials and the temptations and the victories, who will rejoice with you and encourage you, and you allow them to do it because you know they love you. You see, the guy that stands on the street corner and tells the world that the world is going to hell in a handbasket, he's speaking a truth. But because you don't know that he loves you, you hear it in a judgmental way that you just are repelled against that problem. But if someone in your life comes to you and says, when you treat your spouse that way, or when you treat your children that way, or when you do that in this way, or when you don't do this, that's sin. And it's leading you away from the fullness of what God has for you. If it's somebody that you know loves you, you'll receive that. Even if it's not what you want to hear, you'll think about it. And you might ask them for help and encouragement to lift you up and help you make it through those moments. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of bread. The breaking of bread is our corporate identity in worship. It is belonging to and being a part of the community of faith. Jesus called this community the church. It was Jesus who said, against my church, the gates of hell will not prevail. It wasn't something man made up. It's something God designed. And he even did that back with the nation of Israel. But Jesus said, against my church, the gates of hell will not prevail. And the breaking of bread symbolizes the local community of people gathered together to worship God and share life with one another. A local community of people gathered together. Our corporate worship reveals the heart of God. Our corporate worship reveals the wisdom of God. Our corporate worship reveals the will of God. Our corporate worship is a place where God speaks, where God's grace washes over us. Our corporate worship is a place where we turn to Jesus and follow Him. Every Sunday we will have a confession. Every Sunday we will say the peace of the Lord. That means that anything I had against you is no longer against you. We have forgiven as we've been forgiven. We are in love with one another. And as God's peace flowing in us and through us to each other. And then we come and celebrate Holy Communion. The very presence and invitation of Christ for us. His grace washing over us. Our corporate worship is a place where we turn to Jesus and follow Him. If I'm a part of a team, cannot show up every once in a while and expect the team to be everything it's meant to be. It won't happen. Our corporate worship is not about us as individuals, if we feel like it or not. Our corporate worship is about the community of God's people gathered together to worship Him because He is worthy. Because that song that we sang about all the names of God and who He is true. And He alone is worthy of our praise. Even if I don't feel like it, He's worthy of it. And it's not about me, it's about the community. It's the one place that the people of God come together to praise Him for who He is. And turn to Jesus and follow Him. It is the primary place. The church is the primary place in which this takes place. And it is a spiritual discipline. that all people can easily do, even young children or old people. All you got to do is show up. All you got to do is show up. It's the primary place in which we learn. It's the primary place in which we live. It's the primary place in which we become. It's the primary place in which we are seen as the children of God to the world. When the church gathers together to worship, it is a discipline. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and the prayers. Prayer. Becoming a person who engages in conversation with God, speaking to God, and listening to God, that He would speak to us. Building intimate times of relationship with God, resting in and enjoying His presence. Resting in and enjoying His presence. How many of you know that you can grow in intimacy with a person just by being in the same room together, sitting together? You don't have to say anything. You can just be sitting next to each other and your hearts are drawing near to one another. So it is with God. Resting in and enjoying His presence. Sharing our life, the things in our heart, the things in our mind, and also listening, allowing Him to speak. And sometimes just being with Him. Resting in and enjoying His presence. And listen to how Luke describes that experience. When the church did that, when the people of God, when the sheep followed Jesus and heard His voice, Luke says, awe came upon everyone. Because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. And all who believed were together. And they had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods. And they would distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. They become generous givers of all that God had given them. Knowing that there was a far greater purpose for life than living for oneself. Whose voice are you following? Do you realize that there's a far greater purpose in life than living life for yourself? What if there were devices that would allow you to hear the voice of God? Would you use them? And if you did use them, and the voice of God started growing faint, becoming broken, or dropping out altogether, would you be willing to move? To make an adjustment? So that God's voice would once again become clear? And you could engage in the relationship that these devices enable for you to enjoy. Those who have been baptized, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, the breaking of bread, fellowship, and the prayers. And day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Can you hear me now?
Stand together and proclaim our faith in the words of the 19th verse.
We believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. Of one being with the Father, through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, He was crucified. worship continues with the prayers of the people.
Lord,
for your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Those we remember with memorials: Doris Flack, Sam Getz, Bill Daly, and all those who are recently deceased. Aaron Lyon. Are there others? Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. We pray for your peace and hope to fill the hearts of those affected by violence, and we pray that you would change the hearts of those who might cause harm to others. We pray for those serving in our armed forces. We pray for our first responders. We pray for St. Barnabas Episcopal School and all schools. We pray for victims of storms and other bad weather events. We pray for relief for migrants and refugees. We pray for our counseling center, Faith at Work, Kairos, and our missions in Honduras, Southeast Asia, Vietnam, Brazil, and Tanzania. We pray for all children, born and unborn, that they may have a chance to grow into all that you desire for them. We pray for the persecuted church throughout the world. Give our brothers and sisters courage to face the dangers ahead of them, in your mercy and grace to know that you are with them in their suffering. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, and enjoy Him. This week is centering prayer on Wednesday night from 5:15 to 6 o'clock here in the chapel. So you can come and learn what that's about. It's a great opportunity to share in that. Also in the bulletin, you'll see a lot of announcements. I encourage you to read through them and look through them. Our DOK group is going to be doing or hosting a sort of an informational time of learning what the DOK is all about, the Daughters of the King. If you come to that class, it doesn't mean you're going to automatically join their group. But if you'd like to learn more about what they do and why they do it, that's what this group is about. This meeting is about opportunity to learn what the DOK does, why they're on, how they serve the church, and what's that about. So come and share and be a part of that as well. You also see that there are some Ultreas coming up. Ultrea is a follow-up to Crucio, but you do not have to have gone to Crucio to participate. It's basically a fellowship dinner and a time of some singing some songs and small group around a table, hearing someone share their testimony and enjoying that fellowship and that relationship together. A little bit of the fellowship that we talked about. And then Allison has an announcement in here about children's ministry and some ways in which they need help and assistance. And I know she'd love to talk with you if you're interested in helping out with that ministry as well. Karen Lyon's funeral service will be on May 20th, right here at St. Barnabas at 10 o'clock. At 10 o'clock, a reception following the service in Harvard. So please mark your calendar so you can come and be a part of that. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice. Oh, and the faith that we're bags are on the pews. I'm sitting here holding it and still almost forgot the announcement. So if you look inside the faith that we're bags are some items of things they need to help restock the shelves to help reach out to our community. So if you'll pick one of these bags up, there's some in the chapel, some along the aisles on the way, and bring it back on the third Sunday of the month, that will help faith that we're in that ministry continue to reach our community. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice. and Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing. Always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly I would now to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And in the last day, bring us together with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now that our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say.
Peace of God.
God which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.